Good morning and welcome. It's our pleasure today to have with us Dr. Srikanth Vedantam. He's a professor in the Department of Engineering Design, and he's also the head of the Department of Engineering Design here at IIT Madras. He has a BTech in Mechanical Engineering from IIT Madras and a PhD from MIT in the United States. And he has a lot of industry experience. He has worked with GE Global Research Center in New York. His areas of research include microstructure evolution, microfluidics, and wetting of surfaces by sessile drops. So these are, you know, specific research areas, he, as I mentioned, he has experience in the industry, and he has been here as a researcher, as a faculty, and as a guide for several years now. So he has a lot of experience in dealing with research issues, dealing with students, working with students, and guiding them through their PhD process. So with these words of introduction, I'm very happy to have him here.
Thank you so much.
And we will go on with this discussion. So Srikanth, in your department, what would you classify as traditional areas of research?
Yeah. First, Pratap, I have to tell you that our department is a little unique. We are a department of engineering design, which there are not many of such departments in the country. So strictly speaking, we don't have really a traditional role as such. There are other engineering design definitely focused areas in other countries in different parts of the world. And traditionally, to just answer your question, traditionally there the focus has been on the design process. So what we've seen is most traditional departments of mechanical engineering, electrical, civil, and so on, at least in the undergraduate curriculum, the emphasis is on analysis. So if somebody has already done the design, the students who come out of the departments are able to do the analysis very well. But the design aspect is not emphasized as much. I mean, there are there are times when people do focus on that, but it's definitely not a major focus. So in our department, we have been trying to focus on the design aspects. So to make the long an answer short, in our department, the traditional areas have been focused on materials and then controls aspects for automotive and biomedical engineering.
Within this framework, or maybe even outside of this framework, are there areas that are more recent and considered the modern areas to work in, or maybe the cutting edge areas to work in this field?
Yeah, and the answer to this is probably actually a kind of a wide ranging answer, in the sense that in order to be in the forefront in our department research areas, you have to be able to cut across disciplines. So no longer are you, if you're a traditional mechanical engineer or a traditional electrical engineer, will you be able to bring everything to bear to bring better designs forward? So the ability to be able to transition, at least in terms of being able to understand the language of, if you're a mechanical engineer, understand the language of electrical engineer and what their constraints are, and conversely, if you're an electrical engineer, to understand what a mechanical engineer constraints are, the ability to do that is what is the next frontier in law.
And
I think it's true for many other departments as well.
Okay. So in your department, as you mentioned, since you have this multidisciplinary approach, what sort of issues do incoming MS PhD students face, let's say in the early part of their stay here? What sort of issues do they face, and what are typical approaches you have for handling them that you can expect?
Right. So the main thing that based on the fact that I just mentioned that interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary kind of approach is very important, the one of the main issues is the fact that traditional preparation of incoming graduate students is usually strong in one area. So the way we try to address this is to have them do courses across many disciplines. So the first initial portion is spent in some amount of coursework, which we believe actually it adds a value over the lifetime anyway. So some of this is being addressed through this wide ranging coursework, where people are not sticking to just one area and trying to focus their efforts in very narrow specialties.
Okay. When we talk of research, we tend to think of an academic setting, and students are here in an academic setting, and within that, and research tends to be a specialization in a particular problem, which has a lot of scientific input to it, and so on. In this context, at least with respect to your department, where do you see the industry interest? Because industry typically may have a more immediate term focus. They may not necessarily, they may be interested in long term projects, but typically their focus and thrust is on the immediate future. So where do you see the overlap? Where does industry show interest in activities that you pursue?
Right. It's a good question, because in our department, we actually are expected, there is a natural expectation that we would interact much more closely with the industry and try to address problems right from the industry perspective. But that said, at the end of the day, in an academic environment, what we view is that we want people to try to understand the science aspects. And because the large jumps that can be made in terms of technology and development can be understood only by the application of the science, as if it's well understood. Otherwise, if you look at it purely from industry development perspective, you can the kind of approaches that you can make are only like sort of small tweaks that will help improve things. That will be at a short term. So in that sense, industry does look to our department to try to provide the scientific basis by which we can try to have industrial relevant problems, but with a little bit more long-term perspective. And I think that it's true, while it's true for our department in particular, I think all academic departments should be in that mode, where they're trying to, at least in engineering departments definitely, should be trying to focus on application of science to problems that are just a little bit longer than what the industry perspective.
Yeah, you had also mentioned, for. Like automotive industry and biomedical industry. From their perspective, are there specific kinds of projects that they are looking at an academic environment to show the leadership to help them solve? Yeah. Do you see?
So some of our colleagues are actively participating with the automotive industry in terms of new tire designs, handling of vehicles, in terms of the stability, noise, vibration aspects, and so on. So when the industry is working on those aspects of the problems, usually, as I mentioned, the approaches they take are only leading to small tweaks which will give incremental advances. So what they're looking for in our colleagues and the research areas which our students are engaged in is they can see if they can completely disrupt the technology, they can come to a completely
new. Nice.
So by application of fundamental science.
Okay.
So in the sense that even though we are a technology oriented department, the science aspects are still important and we focus on them, but the application to coming to the next level, next generation of products.
Okay, so the science, the basic understanding pushes the boundary much more significantly than locally tweaking it.
Exactly, that's the point I want to emphasize really for our viewers.
Yeah, that's I think a very valuable insight into the process. Students come in for a postgraduate degree, a master's degree and PhD degree, they come in with some a variety of different backgrounds, different colleges and institutions from which they come in, and then they go through this process. So if you look at that process of 4 or 5 years that they are here, and then maybe even their early career, in what ways do you measure success in their research activity? In what ways should they themselves be measuring their success as a researcher?
So this is a good question, because it's not an easy question to answer. There are various measures of success, but at the end of the day, at least from an academic viewpoint, what I try to advise the incoming students is that they should always focus on the process of trying to solve a problem, not necessarily the specific problem itself.
Okay.
So, in other words, we want people to understand the process by which you are able to take relatively vaguely stated problem, because not many problems will be stated in a very precise fashion, either by the customer in an industry or even a research problem in its initial stages. So how do you take that vaguely stated problem, make it more specific, make very specific assumptions for that problem, try to develop the tools or use appropriate tools to solve it, and then defend what you have, the assumptions you have made and the results, conclusions you are drawing in a coherent fashion. So this is a process of research which I think spans all like, you know, disciplines. And I do emphasize our students and all graduate students that I meet that they should think about this overall process which they are learning. So in other words, tomorrow if they are trained right now in one particular application of this process, so somebody is doing some advanced designs in automotives, but they are understanding the process by which they are going through. Tomorrow if they have to do it in a slightly different discipline or slight, they will be able to carry over this process, the way by which they specify, make the problem more specific, how they like obtain the tools to solve them, and then how they defend the conclusions they make. So as a graduate student and in the academic, this is how I measure the success of a graduate student, okay, in terms of whether they have learned the process.
Great. So. See, when we look at master's students and PhD students, when they get their degree, I mean, the general perception, and to some degree it is true, is that, you know, they are now specialists in a, not just engineering design, but they are specialists in a particular topic in engineering design, and they have, you know, looked at the topic in great detail and so on. So when that is the case, what sort of, you know, what impact does it have, you know, in terms of their professional growth later on, in the sense that what sort of positions do you normally see students in engineering design, graduating students in engineering design, what sort of positions do they tend to take up once they graduate?
So far our department is relatively young. So we've had like, you know, smaller number of people going out after their graduation year. But so far the emphasis has been predominantly into the industry.
Okay.
So we have had people who have gone into the, like, research labs of biomedical companies, as well as in the automotive R&D sector. So but I see there is a trend where people are trying to go into the academic side as well, and we have several students who are right now very focusedly pursuing their academic career as well. So right now the to answer your story, I mean question. In a more focused fashion, it's mostly industrial.
Okay. Well, that's very nice to know. I mean, I think people tend to think that it is, once you do research, you have to do, you probably are moving away from industry, but I guess not. You're saying that in fact, in your discipline, a lot more people goes, I mean, the okay. industry interacts much very well with the students graduating from your department.
Right.
So a little while earlier, you spoke about the process by which, you know, a person becomes a researcher and so on. So to what degree and how much does the interaction between the guide and the student contribute to this process? And in that context, in a more mundane sense, how often do you think students should be meeting their research advisor in during the research process and career?
So for this, I in my own view, in the beginning stages of the of a research, like, you know, a graduate student trying to start their research program, it should be a lot more frequent kind of meeting, maybe even once a week or even at like smaller time frames. The reason I say that is that the process of identifying or making a vague statement of a research problem into something more specific that is more tractable is actually one of the more difficult parts of the research methodology.
Okay.
So considering that we are putting the most difficult aspect at the beginning. I think that's where the interaction should be really like, you know,
more frequent.
So then after that, there will be a stage where, you know, it's just learning tools and implementing them. That part the student, the researcher could just continue to do it on their own. Because first of all, at that point in time, you know, even the meetings get less frequent, maybe even once a month. It's better that way because there's no spoon feeding of tools.
Okay.
Tools is something that we have to be able to pick up at the end of our research training. We should be able to learn how to read an undergraduate textbook or even a master's level textbook to learn the appropriate tools to solve the problem. That part, we have to get that independence. So the initial part where you're still focusing down the problem, maybe a lot more interaction.
Okay, great.
And then once it goes along, then I think it can be as needed, like, okay. You know, how the tools are.
Okay, great. So now to sort of wind up and finish this, close this discussion. What is your advice to students who are aspiring to be, you know, researchers in the field of engineering design? Yeah.
So I would advise them first of all to, you know, try to have much interdisciplinary interests. It will make them first of all like, you know, much more useful to the eventual industry that they go to, or if they go to an academic environment, they'll still be having like, you know, like they'll be able to bring much more to the table if they do that. So first advice is to be much more interdisciplinary and being able to try to like, you know, show interest as well as like, you know, curiosity in subjects that are not immediately related to your specialized area. Then other thing is that I think you know, trying to have a big picture of what you're trying to solve. In other words, lots of times as when we are focused on a research problem, we tend to look at very minute aspects of the problem that we're looking at. But all the time, if you're able to keep a big picture of where this problem is going to fit in, how it's not usual that we solve like a real societal need start to finish, but our each of us will contribute to a small part of
small
this
part of it.
That's what we usually have time for and we are able to focus on. But if you understand where this solution that we are providing fits into the overall picture of our societal need, that helps us really contribute much more than if you were just focusing on your minor problem.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Srikanth, for joining us. We're really glad that you could join us and share your experience with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.